Hey, paisanos, it's the Super Mario Brothers Super Show!
With the Mario Brothers and plumbing's a game, we're not like the others who get all the fame. If your sink is in trouble, you can call us on the double. We're faster than the others, you'll be hooked on the brothers. So hang on to your seat, get ready for adventure and remarkable feats. You'll meet Koopas and Troopas, the princess and the others. Hanging with the plumbers, you'll be hooked on the brothers to the bridge.
Hello and welcome to the debut of Pixels in the Animation from GeekCast Radio Network. I am one of your hosts, Steve, Jeremy, and Mike, and joining me in this epic journey, I guess we'll all have to define epic a different way, is TV's Mr. Neil.
Right, now I'm the co-MC to your Tommy Treehugger.
No.
I wasn't sure if you would even get that.
Oh, no, 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 no. This is not Club Mario.
Isn't it awful?
It is not. Like, okay. Don't get me wrong. Like, I know there are bad cartoons out there. Don't get me wrong. We all know that there are bad cartoons out there. In my 33 years on this planet, at this point in my life, I have come to look at things not just out of nostalgia anymore, but, like, what was going on at the time, insert whatever name, whatever, is, you know, insert product here. What was going on at the time that that was out or that was going on or that was currently airing? Like, so, but yeah, I do agree. Club Mario was the worst idea Nintendo and Fox or whoever.
I'm pretty sure it was all Deke.
Yeah, probably.
Nintendo probably couldn't stop them.
I don't know, because doesn't Nintendo have the copyright on... Well, no.
They do, but if they sign it over... I mean, look what happened with the CDI. I mean, CDI put out those awful games, and Nintendo couldn't do anything about it.
That's true. All right, so... For myself, everybody should know me from TuneCast Classic, TuneCast Beyond, everything else the GeekCast Radio Network does. For Neil, you guys really should go listen to Animation Aficionados at animationaficionados.com.
Yes.
He and his friend Ben, the host, seems how that's the only name he really wants, or he doesn't want a name whatsoever. They, on a weekly, now at this point, bi-weekly basis...
Well, we're back to weekly at the moment.
Oh, okay, well, I never know. So, they discuss, they don't quote-unquote review, but they discuss animation from anime to Ben having a huge hard-on for Spider-Man in any incarnation... I swear to God, you guys have done more Spider-Man episodes than anything else. Isn't it? Okay, sure. I go back and I will revisit something, but I do it in a different way. Like our Beast Wars Beast Machines podcast. A couple of years, we'll go back to it, but we'll do it in a different way where we're going to actually record commentaries about the episodes. So we're not actually doing a, like, oh my God, in retrospect review. But, yeah, they discuss animation with a wide variety of panelists, and there's always usually a crappy ad in the beginning with some awesome music behind it. That website gives Bacon a bad name. Oh, wait, I'm sorry, Beacon. Yeah.
Oh, well.
So yes, we are here now. I think it was a year ago we recorded the introduction to this show. I think it was. I gotta actually look.
I believe so.
But we are here just to remind everybody, June 21st, Friday, June 21st, is the launch date for Pixels in the Animation. Neil and I are going to be reviewing every single episode of 9 different video game cartoons. Mario, Mario 3, Zelda, Captain N, Mario World, the 2 Sonic cartoons, and...
We're going to do Donkey Kong Country.
Mega Man and Donkey Kong Country, yeah. I will say right now that we did have a voicemail oh so long ago when... when we first released the episode 0, and the person basically asked us, well, why don't you do Pole Position, or why don't you do this, or why don't you do that?
Yeah.
The reason why. Well, hold on. I am a firm believer in having physical media to go along with any animation. I am not so anal about it if I have to get it online. If it, like if it's not on DVD or if it's not streaming somewhere online, I will get it legally. But when I set up the schedule, I was like, what's a nice round number? 100 episodes, that's a nice round number for a podcast. And I broke down the schedule of the stuff of each of the episodes. And these probably aren't going to be particularly long podcasts, but they might be in certain cases. I know this one might be particularly long since it's our first episode, and we are reviewing, in episodes 1 and 2 of Pixels in the Animation, we are reviewing 6 cartoons, or 6 episodes of Super Mario Bros. Super Show. But yeah, it was June, oh wow, it was 1 year ago today.
Oh, wow.
June 21st, 2012. Wow. I can't believe I planned that so well. the more obscure the video game cartoon is, or the more that it's not on mass release, it wasn't going to make the cut. I'm not saying that we wouldn't watch it at some point, but I set out with a specific goal in mind for this show. Was to cover the major ones, and yes, I know the majority of it is Nintendo, with the exception of Sonic. Actually, holy crap, it's pretty much all Nintendo with the exception of Sonic.
Well, not Mega Man. That's Capcom. Well,
but it was on the Nintendo, though.
True.
It started on Nintendo, so... so there's that. All right. Any general thoughts about the actual podcast that you want to get out?
Not really, except that very few of these cartoons I would put among my favorites. In fact, I was watching a few of them today, and I was like, oh boy, this sure is 90s animation, isn't it?
Yeah, but it's not bad 90s animation.
Well, some of it is. Some of it holds up better than others.
Running. I will give you the fact right now. The running, the speed running, mm-hmm. when they run away from Koopa, that's bad animation. But the actual character designs and the world, like for me, even now, it's like the video game has popped off the console and come to life. That's exactly how I felt as a kid as well. So that's why I enjoy them. Am I going to have issues with them? Oh, you're damn sure I will. But I want to make it clear, we're not here to just bash these shows.
No,
we are going to point out things we do like about them. Before we get into the actual episodes, we have to talk about where this cartoon came from. It's a combination of Super Mario Brothers and Super Mario Brothers 2, the American version.
I don't think we even need to specify that because nobody really considers the Lost Levels.
Yeah, so. I know.
Unless they're like super anal, but you know.
Yes. But this to me is more like this has, outside of the Koopa Troopas, this has nothing to do with Super Mario Brothers. It has everything to do with Super Mario. Every single character in this is almost from Super Mario Brothers 2.
Well, Super Mario Brothers 2 had just come out around the time that this show was released. And so they were pushing that game hard. And there is some throwback. It was particularly King Koopa throwback right. to the original game, just because, I mean, you're selling the game with the system. You're still kind of marketing it. So, you know, it's like, mm-hmm. hey, here's this character from this game you can get with this really cool video game system. Go out and buy the video game.
Yeah. And let's face it, no one freaking knows who the hell Wart was. You yeah. had to put King Koopa in this cartoon, because if you would have put Wart in here as the villain, no one would have known.
A lot of people thought Wart was Bowser, and that was always, that was like the source of a little bit of arguing when I was a kid. Like, no, mm-hmm. it's a completely different character. Although they did kind of merge the two for this cartoon. There is some Wart in Bowser.
Yeah. There is a little bit of wart in Bowser, and maybe Bowser has warts all over his body. You never know. well, he's a lizard, so. but it's going to be a fun hell of a journey. And with Super Mario Brothers Super Show, it will run from episode 1, which you're listening to now, all the way through episode 15. So, yay, 52 episodes. In 52 television episodes and 15 episodes of a podcast. Yay, math. And we aren't... at first, I was like, hey, let's just review the cartoon segment. And then I thought about it, and I'm like, that isn't really doing the show any real service. So we are going to be discussing the live action as well as the cartoon, although most of my notes come from the cartoon episodes.
Yeah, I only took notes on the live action segments that I thought were really notable. Some of them are kind of forgettable. Others are really worth talking about.
Right. No. Yeah. I mean, normally my live action notes will consist of who the guest was. Mm-hmm. You know, who the guest was, what the situation was. There's going to be something in this very episode later that just creeps me the hell out. So stay tuned for that. So let's get into the first episode after this.
Yo, it's the Mario Brothers, and Plumbing's the game. Found the secret water zone while working on the drain. Lend the princess a hand in the mushroom land. Jump the action with the plumbers, you'll be hooked on the brothers. Now, evil Koopa and his troopers are up to misbehaving. They kidnap the princess, mushroom land needs saving. Abusing and confusing, everybody discovers they can't help.
Time for a new day. But as we always say, neatness counts.
That's right, Mario. And by the way,
put a little piece of spaghetti on your overalls.
You, Luigi. And you have a little bit of spaghetti sauce on your shirt, as usual.
Oh, really? Your shoes are dirty.
And your socks don't match.
Yeah, you got 5 cavities.
Hello?
Hello? You didn't say hello.
I didn't either.
Well, I did. Over here. Hi, are you the Mario Brothers?
Sure are. Oh, you're Nicole Leggett. We watch your show all the time. Mario and I are your biggest fans.
All right, first up in Super Mario Brothers Super Show is The Bird, The Bird. Now, that is the title of the animated short. The title of the actual live-action segment was it? Why so messy? I don't remember.
Yeah, I didn't write that down.
I honestly don't remember what the title of the live action. Because honestly, the DVD, because I have both volumes of the DVD set, mm-hmm. they pretty much list the episodes by the animation episode title, not the live action segment. So,
right.
But no, this is the first episode. Mario and Luigi are arguing. Mario, played by Captain Lou Albano, and Luigi, played by Danny Wells, who did not go crazy. Thank you, Dion the Music Man. That's a leftover from ToonCast Classic Episode 1. And the guest is Nicole Eggert. Nicole Eggert. So yeah, you think all these bad manners and, you know, the whole pratfalls of getting her all dirty. You think that she's going to be pissed, but apparently no. It's okay. It's a sloppy party. I'm sorry. Even in the 90s, as an 8, 9, 10-year-old kid, I have never heard of a sloppy party.
Neither have I. Never. This is cartoon writing at its finest. You know, it's not a cartoon. It was written by people who write cartoons.
Right, yeah.
This was probably written in like 5 minutes.
Yeah. Now, I also did watch... on the DVD, they have, on the volume one, they have, quote-unquote, a brand new interview with Captain Lou Albano. Now, this DVD set was released a number of years ago from Shout Factory, and it's an amazing put-together DVD set, but it's not recent because, as we know, since the DVD set came out, sadly, Captain Lou passed away. But it is interesting to see him... you know, talk about his wrestling stuff, talk about his, you know, his time in Mario. The fact that he almost didn't do the show because they wanted him to shave. But it's, you know, I like the chemistry between the two of them.
Yeah, of anyone on this show, I'm talking about, like, production, casting, out of anyone, I think these two guys made this show work, and they did the best job of anyone.
Yeah. Yeah, it's so cool to see the two. When I was watching this first episode, this may be an insult to the analogy I'm going to make, but these guys are pretty much the 90s, late 80s, early 90s version of Abbott and Costello. Now, people may say, what the fuck are you talking about, DF Joe and Mike? No way. Abbott and Costello are so much better. Hear me out. If you watch these live-action segments and you see not only the slapstick, but just the arguing back and forth, and it doesn't hurt that there's Nintendo game sound effects that could, like, you know, Mario, you got a piece of spaghetti on your sleeve there.
Oh yeah, it never stops. You hear those sound effects.
I love the sound effects though. Those sound effects are so awesome. Just love those sound effects. But yeah, that's the live action segment. Getting into the animation. The bird. A birdo mistakes Toad for her baby because she is blind as a bat. Okay, so that's the basic plot. We are going to be talking about this in two different ways. We're going to give our good thoughts and our bad thoughts after we talk about the overall plot. The good thoughts are going to be termed fire flowers, and I think the bad, the negative things we'll have to say are going to be called Goombas. Because everybody loves a Goomba, right? What did you think of the overall plot of the episode?
Well, I think this is going to be an opinion similar to all the episodes, which is that it seemed like because they were doing 52 episodes that the story was just kind of thrown together kind of quickly. I mean, these aren't like really deep episodes. They're not really deep stories. They're just kind of... basic premises that they get to write around, and I like that they took some liberties with the game. I mean, like, Birdo does not act like this at all in the game. Yeah. So yeah, if they stuck to the game mechanics, it would be kind of a really boring cartoon. But the Birdo almost seemed like it looked like something out of Muppet Babies, just the way the eyes were shaped. It was very I like that they picked some of the odd villains. Like, they had Flurries in this episode. I was like, oh my god, the Flurries! it's like an odd enemy that's from like World 4 of Super Mario 2 that they don't really show up a lot. So to see them in the cartoon was kind of weird.
Right. Well, because I think the reason, obviously, why they show up is, as you stated, World 4.
Yeah.
If I remember correctly, in the game, is the ice world.
Yes.
So, this being, you know, Snowy River, or whatever. I like the plot. I think it's cool that, you know, this show, even back then, the cliches are so obvious. And we'll get to that later in this episode with each episode after this. Because each one of them have a specific theme outside of this one. I guess this one's basic theme is, hey, my baby's gone missing and I'm going to mistake this giant mushroom for my child because my glasses are too far down on my nose.
I like the joke where she had the milk carton and she looks at it and she's like, oh, it was a bad picture anyway.
I know. All right, so let's go pluck some fire flowers.
It's a bomb! And I was hoping for a nice salami sandwich.
Oh, no! King Koopa must have found us!
Look out! Here comes a whole squad room of King Koopa's bombers! Good going, guys!
Not good enough! Those other Albatross are up to something!
So, we each have a bunch of fire flowers, I think. And you just mentioned it before the break here.
the humor.
Well, have you seen this person on the milk carton? I remember those days. I just, like, you know, you don't have those anymore. I mean, I'm sure, like, don't get me wrong, there are plenty of missing people in this country. But you don't have those anymore because guess what, ladies and gentlemen? Milk doesn't come in cartons anymore. It comes in plastic bottles. But yeah, I did think that was funny. I also liked Pasta Power, everyone. Insert Scrappy-Doo here.
Oh, God. That saying and holy ravioli, you hear that in every single episode. I'm like, oh, my God.
So many Italian food sayings. This is so funny.
Yeah.
Did you have any moments that you liked in this?
Just the little asides like that. I kind of like the animation in this one a little better than most of the other episodes. It seemed like a lot of money went into this episode. It might have been the pilot.
Yeah.
So far, of all the ones that I've watched, it's the best animated. Well, I was going to go into, like, the weird stuff, but I should probably save that for the dislikes.
For the Goombas?
Yeah.
Oh, boy. All right, so let's go stomp some Goombas.
Your extremist, most royal and regal Koopiness.
Watch it, soldier. When I want my feet licked, I'll ask for it. I want my feet licked. This will be the last time those pinhead plumbers throw a monkey wrench into my evil plans.
Get out of the way, you stupid Goomba. Alright, the only thing I had written down for this is, as I said before, the Birdo has her damn glasses on it on the same. The only thing that's different is that why she can't see is they've gone too far down her nose. That's all they did. Seriously, it would have been better if she actually lost her glasses altogether. Like, if she didn't have them on. And she just wouldn't listen to Toad, and you would think that even in a blurred vision, you could see that a giant mushroom is not your baby bird. So.
Well, it's old school cartoon logic, I think. It's like, it's not necessarily that she had the glasses on too low. It was like, there's kind of an old trope about, like, ditzy old women who you know, haven't had their prescription checked in, like, 20 years, so even with glasses on, they can't see. They're wearing, like, Coke bottle glasses, and they're still blind. So there's there's that. But yeah, this character was just kind of stupid in places, and then suddenly at the end she's hyper competent. She's like, "Oh, you found my real baby. I'll help you."
Yeah, and she over-salivated way too much. Like, like seriously, I know that that's fit and fiddle, but like the whole time in the animation when her mouth was closed, right around her lips, it was like she was drooling the entire time because part of her lips were white from the spit.
Yeah, it didn't look like spit though. It looked like mung or something. I don't know.
Some sort of bodily fluid that comes out of the mouth. Yeah. I don't know. What else didn't you like? What are some of the weird things?
The design of the Koopa Troopas. Well, this is I'm only gonna riff on this because it's the first episode, but even though it goes on throughout the entire series, that the Koopa Troopas don't really look like Koopa Troopas. They look like, I don't know, they look like weird midget Ninja Turtles. Yeah, and they all have the same dopey voice. I can't quite place the voice, but it reminds me of something. I'll probably know in the next episode.
Yeah, I saw that too. I was like, wait, that's a Koopa Troopa?
Oh, I know what it's like. It's like the "Which way did he go, George?" voice. Like, which way did he go, George?
Which way did he go? I turned the fire hose on, George. Bring it up here, Junior.
Oh, but don't move no more.
What else besides the Koopa Troopas thing?
I'm kind of drawing a blank here. It's not so bad in this episode, but it's the whole fact that they kind of skipped over the super mushroom, and like for some reason,
straight to the fire flower.
Well, it's not just the fire flower. The star man works the same way. No, we don't see a star man in this episode, but
yeah,
it's like everything goes to that fiery Mario mode, and the fiery Mario mode is just referred to as Super Mario. That's kind of I can kind of understand why they did it, but it's like it changes a fundamental aspect of the game in a weird way that it's kind of a disconnect that's just odd.
Mm-hmm.
It's like I watch this, I'm like, that's not the way it's in the game.
Yeah, it's strange. And what is also strange, even though it's the first episode for us, the audience, is it in this episode or... Yeah, it is this episode. After Princess Toadstool, worst name ever, tells Mario about the Fire Flower. After he touches it and becomes Fire Mario, he says, "I always love when that happens."
I noticed that, yeah.
I was like, if she just explained it to you and you don't know what the hell it is, how do you always love when that happens? I was like, well, what the hell?
Like I said, this was probably written in like 10 minutes. Yeah. Did you notice that this episode, I think one other episode, Toad has a different hat?
Yeah, his hat changes size. It sometimes changes color.
Yeah.
I didn't realize a mushroom top was a hat, not something that's... like, I always thought that was attached to his head.
I think it is supposed to be attached to his head, but in the cartoon they had a different interpretation.
Well, if it can turn into a parachute, I guess it would say that it's a different interpretation, all right.
Yeah.
And I'll talk about Toad here in a little bit with a different episode, because after watching these first 6 episodes that we're going to talk about today, I am so sick of a certain thing that happens with Toad. All the freaking time. So we are going to move on to the next episode.
Tightened. I thought we were loosening them. I'll finish up over here. You go get the phone.
All right.
And put it on speakerphone.
What do you mean speakerphone?
I fixed it special. Just push the third pepperoni from the right.
Mario Brothers Plumbing. You block them, we clear them.
Mario Brothers can't hunt.
Whoa. It's that bully, Sergeant Slaughter.
I heard that. Drop and give me 10.
Okay, Sarge. We're doing them. You stupid speakerphone.
You better have my steam cabinet fixed. I'm stuck in traffic on the Brooklyn Bridge, but I'm taking a shortcut, and I'll be right there.
How can you take a shortcut off the Brooklyn Bridge? That's a goof.
It helps if you have a Sherman tank, bozo.
It's as ready as it'll ever be. All right, I'll go check on the pizza. That Sergeant Slaughter's a pretty tough customer. I better check this baby out. As you were, troop. As I was pulling a pizza out of the oven. Proceed on schedule, doughboy. Hop two, double time it. Meanwhile, I'll check this baby out. See how she works. I don't like the way this thing is thumping.
Why don't you come up into the kitchen? You can hardly hear it from here.
All right, up next is Butch Mario and the Luigi Kid. In the live action segment, we have Sergeant Slaughter. Woohoo!
Sergeant Slaughter. Yeah, this show, I mean, it's got video games, it's got professional wrestlers. What could possibly go wrong? So you see a cartoon with, you see like a kid show with Sergeant Slaughter in it. I mean, he's like fresh off of G.I. Joe. He hasn't turned Iraqi sympathizer yet. So this is pre-WrestleMania 7.
Yeah. As a kid, I never knew about Captain, like, for me as an 8, 9, 10-year-old, wrestling was, at that time, Hulk Hogan versus Roddy Piper.
Yeah.
That's what wrestling was for me. Of course I loved Mean Gene and all that stuff, but, like, I never was, like, that deep into it as a 9-year-old. And I didn't even know until later that Captain Lou was a wrestler. So, obviously I knew Sergeant Slaughter from wrestling and, as you said, from G.I. Joe. And just seeing him in this is so cool. And just the interactions he has with Daddy Wells is just so awesome. It's just so great because, like, it's so weird. And why does he need a steam, whatever the hell that thing is? Honestly, like, the steam trunk, that's what it is. Why does he need that? Okay, sure, I get it. Steam is a form of therapy for your muscles and all that, but it seems weird that he would take a steam trunk to a bunch of plumbers.
There's a lot of things that get taken to the Mario Brothers plumbing that, like, makes absolutely no sense. It's like, why does Inspector Gadget show up here episodes later? I think it's another case of these guys were just writing what they could as fast as they could. And they were like, hey, you know those old cartoons where the guy gets like a steam bath and he comes out 3 feet tall? Let's do that, Joe. And so that's how this episode was born, I'm guessing.
Yeah, pretty much. All right, let's go on and get to the Fire Flowers.
Evil King Koopa had grabbed Princess Toadstool and hidden her away in the Wild West. Wanted, dead or alive, Butch Mario and the Luigi Kid.
Hey, Mario, I told you we shouldn't have come. This place is full of dangerous outlaws.
Hey, that's you guys.
Us?
Reward, 10,000 gold pieces.
1,000 gold pieces, I'm taking you crooks to jail and let their gold to the bank.
Hang on. Don't you want to read the part about how dangerous we are?
You? Ha! I'll show you dangerous.
Mario, it's getting sticky. Do something.
So we have our fire flowers in hand, and I gotta say, I really enjoyed Butch, Mario, and Luigi Kid. I enjoyed it more than I thought I would. What a weird Western video game tale this is. Hey, look, it's Super Mario Bros. 2, Level with the Logs, which is the first world. It's interesting to see it not in pixelated form in a video game. Like, see how it would look animated. I don't think it got pulled off as well, because in the game... Well, in the game, there's one giant log, and then as you go across, there's smaller log. Like, the logs in the episode were too long, I think. Because the logs in the game are not as long as what it was in the episode.
Yeah. Well, again, they're just taking elements from the game, and they're kind of weaving them into these kind of slapdash stories that they're throwing together. I mean, a lot of these cartoons are just taking like really rough, basically trope type outlines. Like, hey, let's do a Western episode. Let's do Jack and the Beanstalk. Let's do, I don't know, just to be ironic, Alice in Wonderland, which I don't think they actually did an episode on Alice in Wonderland, although they should have, because that's what Mario is based on. But yeah, it's like, in fact, my friend Pablo actually pointed this out. It's like they just kind of took whatever fairy tales they could find, whatever, you know, movie tropes they could find, and they would just kind of throw them at Mario and kind of work in little details from the game. And they really weren't thinking about accuracy. Otherwise, you know, they would be more accurate with the power-ups.
Yeah, that's true. Incoming cartoon at 12 o'clock. I love Slaughter doing the commercial breaks. I love, like, that is just so awesome. They should have had him on every episode.
I'm surprised they didn't have him do a G.I. Joe reference, because Deke had the license for G.I. Joe at the time.
Yeah.
Oh, well.
What'd you like about this one? Anything?
This not one of the better episodes, I thought, but I did like that. Well, when I say like, it's kind of like a goofy artifact in the episode, but there's a fire piranha plant in this episode. They didn't show up until Super Mario Bros. 3. What the hell, Deke?
Yeah.
It's just in there. I'm like, wait a minute. But that was kind of funny. But
and I don't remember the cacti showing up until Mario World.
The cacti were actually in Super Mario 2.
What level were they on?
They're in one of the desert levels.
Maybe I don't know. Maybe I didn't. I don't know. Because usually in that game, I usually just hit warp 4 and go to the ice level. Oh boy. All right. So let's go stomp on some Goombas.
I'll drop by in a few weeks to accept your surrender. Starve well, my pretty princess.
Get out of the way, you dumb Goomba. Is it just me, or does the sheriff character have a German accent?
He does, and for some reason they gave Mouser a German accent. He has it throughout the entire series.
Mouser? Yep. Where's Baxter Stockman when you need him?
Not that Mouser.
Mouser was one of the Mario 2 villains, right?
Yeah, he was the end boss in two or three stages. I don't remember.
Okay. Yeah, I wasn't offended, but I was caught off a little off guard with the whole German accent for Mouser. What else didn't you like about this one?
Nothing specific. Maybe it's just a little roughly animated. Some of the scenes are kind of weird. Like when, is it this one where Luigi gets caught in a bomb blast and you have to take him outside because he can't breathe or something? And it's like,
no, that's
Am I getting?
It's not. Yeah, you're getting ahead of yourself. That's later.
Okay.
This one was, wait, no, was it this, one? I just watched these episodes today. I just watched them before we recorded. And if I can't remember what I just watched, I'm really in trouble.
I think it is. I know there aren't any other Western episodes on here.
Did they? Yeah, it is this one because they go into the mine, and they go the wrong way, and they're using the bombs. Yeah, it is. It is this one. Because not King, but whatever Koopa's supposed, you know, Blackbeard or Black Bart or whatever he's supposed to be. throws her down a mine shaft. Yeah, it is this one. All right, so let's head to Cremalot. Yay.
It's a silly place.
...should be taken care of. Well, I have a move here.
I know, but we haven't got all day.
Okay, here it is.
That's it?
That's my move.
After all that planning, that's your move?
That's it.
I finally got you, Edison.
That's it?
That's it.
That's your move?
That's it.
Checkmate! I just beat you there, look at that.
One of these
checkmate.
Days, I am going to get... I know, I see, checkmate, I see.
Look at that.
Oh, sure, just keep eating.
I mean, after all, let nothing bother that beautiful girlish figure of yours. I'm coming. Oh, hi, Squirt. Who are you?
A sad-eyed orphan. No parents, no brothers, no sisters. Just me in the shadow.
Oh, what a sad story. Come in, sweetheart. Oh, please, come out of my house. Listen, Squirt, you don't have to have a name, do you?
Patty, the sad-eyed orphan.
Oh, Mario, come here. We have a guest. This is my brother, Mario. Mario, this is Patty, the sad-eyed orphan.
Nice to meet you, Patty, the sad-eyed orphan. Where you from?
Well, I've been drifting for about 6 months now. You know, living off the land. Life is tough when you don't have any parents to love and take care of you. No one even cares that today is my birthday.
Up next is King Mario of Cremalot.
Yes.
Could they be any more obvious?
Might as well go to Sword in the Stone.
Which or the did. Plunger
yeah.
in the stone. The golden plunger in the stone. Yeah. Oh, boy. All right, so in the live-action segment, we have... what's her name? Whitney from the Wonder Years? Or Winnie, or...
Is that who that was?
Yes.
Oh, wow. I was like, who...
Danica McKellar or something? Yeah, whoever the hell. Yeah. Let me look it up just in case, because I know the Wonder Years fans will just... Holy crap, they got this.
She's looking good now.
let me see. Wayne, where is... It was the Wonder Years, right? Yeah, I could have sworn. Where is... Yeah, Gwendolyn Winnie Cooper, Danica McKellar.
See, I just couldn't place her for some reason. I was like, I know that face.
Yep. Well, you had to have Kevin's voiceover talking about her in order to realize who she was.
Yeah, he was too busy going to Universal Studios to watch his little brother play in the championships.
Warp whistle! but yeah, that's who that was. Now, I would have thought that the parents would have been like, when the parents finally show up, I would have thought that they would have said, hey, here's basically Mario Brothers meets Wonder Years. I thought they would have used the parents from the show, but they didn't.
That would have been awesome. But they
that would have been so cool. Yeah. all right, so King Mario in Cremalot. Basically, Mario is Arthur. The old wizard is Merlin.
What was his name in this? It was like...
Marvin.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's... So... The only reason why I'm... negative about this episode is because I've seen so many better versions of the Arthurian legend, both in books and on film and in television. This is one of those episodes that just shouldn't have been made because it doesn't translate well. Like, this is like dropping... it's like taking a Solid Snake and trying to fit him into fighting Dr. Wily or some, you know, some weird thing. Like, God, one of these things just doesn't belong here.
Well, it's kind of par for the course. It's like, this is how I see every episode. But what was weird about this one is that they did both Excalibur legends. Like, they had the sword and the stone, obviously the plunger and the toilet, or the sink.
Yeah,
they had that. But they also did the Lady of the Lake.
The Lady of the Lake, yeah.
Which I thought was kind of weird.
Yeah, it was very, very strange. All right, so let's just... Yeah, so let's go ahead and get to the fireflies, or fire flowers. Holy crap, fireflies. Jesus Christ. I can't think.
Oh, there's an episode idea. Mario does Firefly.
Yeah, the Nathan Fillion fangirls would be screaming in terror.
Now we never get back to Brooklyn.
Take it easy, Luigi. Things could be worse. We're trapped in a dungeon about to be executed. How could things be any worse?
Well, for one thing, the ceiling could lower until it flattens us like a pizza.
So we're all super powered with fire flowers. Mario in an Arthurian legend, while funny, it's kind of obvious, and it's just, like you said, it's... I thought it was funny at certain moments, but after that, I just go downhill. I like the animation. I what I'm finding about this show, we're only three episodes in, and I know it's because it's for an American audience. They have to bring in, like, and we'll get to the food thing later, but they got to bring that in. They got to bring in the whole real world American thing of, oh, plungers, and oh, drains, and oh, plumbers. And I get, they're plumbers in a strange land. I get that. They got transported. Just like, you know, later in this podcast lifespan, we will talk about a kid who got sucked into his television with his dog. You know, but I didn't like this episode at all. I thought it was just, I don't know. Do you have anything interesting or good to say about this one?
The only interesting note on this is that I think this is the only time that the paratroopers show up. And I think it might have been like a mistake in the cartoon, because everywhere else in this cartoon you have Bezos flying the flying enemies from Mario 2, but then in one shot you have the paratroopers, and they're making the Bezos sound. So I'm like, oh, that's weird.
Yeah. All right, let's go stomp on some Goombas.
You pasta-brained plumbers have foiled my plans again. That's the way the meatball bounces. Then, as the old saying goes, he who coops and runs away lives to coop another day.
All right. Things that stuck out to me and Goombas that nearly killed me in this episode. The Bezos, you mentioned them. To me, they look just like flying Shy Guys.
Well, that's kind of what they are, but... They sound annoying because they're like, well, they're Bezos, so they must sound like bees. So every time you see them, they're like, bzzz. And I'm like, ugh. You know, you don't have to do that sound effect all the time, do you? Oh, God, you're going to do it every time.
Yeah, something they don't have to do every time, but they do it every time. Yeah. Both in the live-action segments and in the animation. We're only three episodes into this series. I'm so sick of Luigi screwing shit up and talking backwards.
Talking backwards.
He'll say, what did he say? There go. He basically talks like Yoda in certain points. He basically backwards speaks. Like, he'll say, backwards go to the. It's. next time you're watching episodes, look for it or go back to this episode if you dare, and it happens. It just does. I didn't care for that. Cupola for a Loopa. The rhyming in this is just horrible.
It's the rhyming and the puns. It's just,
yeah. Well, some of the puns I'm okay with. Some of them, not all of them. What didn't you like about Cram-a-Lot?
It's hard to really separate the good from the bad, because sometimes I'll see something that's bad and I'll still laugh at it and therefore count it as good. So
yeah,
this is just kind of like, it's, I kind of laugh at it because it's bad, and so I don't know which category to throw that in. So what I'll do here is I'll just add in one more thing that I thought was kind of funny but also kind of stupid, which is at the very end, Mario gets crowned the king of Cram-a-Lot. And they're like, okay. So Marvin throws him on a tread machine, and he's like, well, if you're going to be king, you have to be fit. No more pasta for you. And Mario's like, give up being morbidly obese? Never. And he runs away. So
yeah, that wasn't a good message. Yeah, for the
that's
kids.
That's kind of a running theme that happens in at least one more episode that I've watched so far.
Yeah, yeah. And like I said earlier, we'll get to the whole food in the Mushroom Kingdom thing. So
it's almost like Garfield and Overdrive, just the pasta thing.
Yeah, kind of. All right, so we're going to move on to the next episode.
You stunade.
What's the matter with you telling them that Delilah Zeta's coming over? You know Luigi and Marion are nuts about this guy. But I forgot.
All right, okay, you forgot. Okay, look, the only thing we could do now is make sure that we keep them out of muscle-touching range, all right?
Up next is Mario's Magic Carpet. In the live-action segment, you have the guest Lyle Alzado.
Yeah.
No clue. I'm gonna look him up.
I think.
Okay, because
who that is. I think he's one of those football players that kind of transitioned into being like
an actor.
Yeah, a sitcom star, so to speak.
Yeah. Oh, well, he, sadly, oh, God, ladies and gentlemen, if you want to fast forward about 5 seconds, please do, because I'm going to grow very, very morbid with this next comment. The Super Mario Brothers Super Show killed this guy.
Oh.
He passed away May 14th, 1992.
See, that's not as bad as the joke I was going to make. I had a joke already prepared, which was that, you know, sitting there on the couch with Lou Albano in drag, he probably felt the brain tumor coming on right there.
He did play for 3 teams in the NFL. He played for the Broncos, the Browns, and the Raiders. So he was a football star. He was involved in countless youth organizations. Pursued an acting career in both movies and television. Played himself in he played himself in an episode of Small Wonder in 88. So, Vicky the Robot and Super Mario Brothers Super Show killed him. Great. actually, he did die away. He did die from steroid usage. So that's not good at all. Don't use drugs, kids. Dare, I tell you.
You know,
do not dare to be stupid.
But bringing this back to a positive note, and there is a wrestling connection here, because one of his sitcom starring roles was in a short lived sitcom called Learning the Ropes, which was about a professional wrestler.
Interesting.
Yeah, and I only know about this because of WrestleCrap.com. Thank you, Artie Reynolds.
Do you have any good points to this one? Because if not, we can just skip Firefly. Like, we didn't find any Fireflies this time, because I have nothing. Like, I cannot stand this episode, ladies and gentlemen. It is so, so bad.
Oh, God. I don't know what possesses them to have Lou Albano and Danny Wells in drag. And this isn't the only time they do it.
Don't tell me that. I haven't watched all of this
You were in for some pain. But this, they were playing the cousins of the Mario Brothers. It was like the Great Gianni series in real life.
Oh my God. All right, well, let's go stomp on some Goombas.
Guard, throw them in the slave quarters, but bring me the pretty one.
I guess he means her.
These priceless jewels are yours when you join my harem.
Me join a harem? Oh, give me a break. Harems are from the stupid olden days.
I like the stupid olden days. Besides, you have no choice.
So, stomping on Goombas. I think I asked you off air that the show was around 88, 89. And it's a number of years, a little, even though the legend of Aladdin had been around for a long time. Like for me, I didn't really catch on until 92 with the Disney Aladdin. So I was going to make a whole reference to that, but this came before that. And watching this episode, I was paying attention to it, but I wasn't paying attention to it. I didn't realize it's not Mario's flying carpet. It's Mario's flying carpets, because the carpets have car parts in them. Seriously? Oh, my God.
Oh, jeez.
Did you not see that?
I didn't wipe that
from your brain.
I just kind of took note of the episode title, but I didn't take a really close look at it. So that just totally went by me.
Yeah, they are flying car pets. Yeah, that was a little strange because I just figured, okay, well, Mario's on a flying car. Or Mario's in a flying carpet. That's fine. And then I realized, oh, wait, no. Too bad there isn't a DeLorean model. okay, what game are the pigeons from?
They're in Mario 2.
They are?
Yep. In fact, they're in the first one you see is in level 1-2. It's the thing is they don't really fly in the game. They're on the flying carpet.
The ones you have to jump on and then jump off of. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
I remember them now.
Yeah. And the funny thing about them in this cartoon is that they're like Pokemon. They can only say their name. So every time you see them, they're like Pidget, Pidget, Pidget. And
yeah.
Another weird blast from the future.
That's why Luigi speaks their language so well, because all she has to do is say pigeon. It's like, they're like, what'd you tell him, Luigi? I told him that Koopa's carpet is tastier than art. Really? By saying pigeon four different... Like, oh my God. The pigeon and the cheapy. They're both forms of Morse code. And
I don't know.
Yes, this is...
I don't know how they averted so many chances of carpet munching jokes.
Oh, God. I think it was a little too early for the rug munching joke.
I know, but
you have to wait until 95 with some rats in a mall for that. yeah, and this is the episode that pretty much scarred me. I can't believe that Danny and Captain Lou would even go for, like, what about this is funny? Like, this isn't even a comedy bit. This is the annoying family member bit.
Yeah.
Like, I just, at first, I kid you not, I actually made this even worse. Because at first, when I first, like, when in the first part of the live-action segment, when they're on the phone with each other, technically, because they're doing the quote-unquote female voices on the phone, I thought they were their girlfriends at first. I didn't catch the whole thing about, I didn't even hear the term cousin. I just, okay, they're crazy. That's really all I heard, and I'm like, oh, God. But no, yeah, Captain Lou and Danny should have never dressed up in drag, and you telling me that it happens again is just like, oh God.
Yeah.
I don't want to see that again.
And it's probably
ever.
Worse.
How hard was it back then to cast somewhat semi-attractive women that would actually, like, that would be believable to be a, like, instead of making them a family member, make them, like I said, the girlfriends, like, how hard would that have been? I don't know. Anyway.
Someone just thought that was funny. It was like, let's put these two aging men in dresses. And my God, Captain Lou could barely hide his mustache. I was having like Cesar Romero flashbacks.
Wow. Oh man. All right, we're gonna move on to the next episode.
Mario, what do you suppose our new neighbor wants us to help him with his latest experiment? I mean, who is this guy anyhow?
Yeah. Dr. Frank N. Stein from Pennsylvania.
Oh, meatball. That's not Pennsylvania. That's Transylvania.
So it's Dr. Stein from Transylvania. So what?
So what? Okay. Frank N. Stein. Say it fast.
Frankenstein.
Not that fast. A little slower with me.
Frank N. Stein. Frank N. Stein. Frank N. Stein.
Frankenstein from Transylvania! Cue the CCR. Rolling down the river.
Well, I think the original version of it did have that song, and that's something we forgot to mention, is that there were songs in these episodes, and they've been mercifully removed.
Yeah, there's going to be songs in many of the Nintendo cartoons that were removed due to rights and permissions and whatever else. Dr. Frank N. Stein is the guest.
I was going to say really quick about the music. You could usually tell where they were because there was usually like a montage where no one's speaking.
Right. Yeah.
But yeah, Dr. Frankenstein, and it took them a really long time to figure out who that was.
Yeah.
I always say comedy loves a slow thinker, but that's a little too slow.
Well, Luigi had it.
Yeah.
He just had to explain it to Mario, and let's face it. Even though Mario, in general, is the one that pretty much can do anything in the games, Luigi in the show is the better thinker. And they kind of proved it with this live-action segment in this episode, the fact that Mario has lasagna for brains. Or lasagna on the brain, or whatever. I don't know. Any other thoughts on the live action?
Just what happened at the end, which was that the brains of the Frankenstein monster and Mario got swapped at one point, and the way they cured him was to just hit each one of them on the head.
Yeah.
So it wasn't that the brains got switched. It was just that Mario was being particularly stupid at that moment.
Wasn't that funny either, sadly. All right, let's go searching for some fire flowers.
Ouch! I gotta tell you, Luigi, I'm working up one big appetite.
Oh, so is he. We can't keep this up forever, Mario. There's too many of them. I mean him.
Wait a macaroni minute. I got an idea. Dance, Luigi.
You lost your noodle.
Dance, dance.
So we are all super powered up and the Koopa Troopers are so dumb, it's funny. I love the voices on them, but yes, you're right. It is the exact same voice for each one of them, but...
It's the Lenny voice.
The whole card game thing. Isn't that this episode, or is it
It is this episode, yeah.
Yeah, the card game, because that's how they're like, hey, wait a second. It's the Super Mario Brothers. I just love the Koopa Troopas. I think the... Was this show big on stock?
Stock?
Animation?
Not that I could see it. I didn't notice any pieces of animation that got reused a lot.
Yeah, so this was all, like, each week or each, however long it took them to make an episode, it was all, you know, done each time. So yeah. That's, I like that. I like that, again, I like seeing how the game can just pop to life for me, like, from different situations and whatever else, and I don't see, like, I know the Koopa Troopas are dumb creatures, but I don't see them being that dumb to being, like, if Mr. Slate can see through, you know, Cowboy Fred and Barney and Drag and Jetsons Meet the Flintstones, the Koopa Troopas can surely see Mario and Luigi's face. All they did was dress up. They just put different clothes on. Seriously, you can't. Oh God.
But think about the analogy that you just made. How many of those Fruity Pebbles commercials were basically the same idea? It was just Barney putting on a disguise and Fred couldn't recognize him.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Do you like anything about this one?
Well, you know, I when I was going through these episodes, I was like, okay, I'm not going to have a lot of good to say about the actual show, so I was just basically looking for any oddities that are from the game and any rare characters. And in this one, I spotted a claw grip. It was like on the screen for maybe a second, and he was steering Koopa's boat.
And I, Oh, yeah.
And interesting note about that character is that character is not actually in Doki Doki Panic. They added that to Super Mario 2. Yeah, so you have an American exclusive character right there.
Go USA! All right, let's go stomp on some Goombas.
I got him!
No, that's the other one! Hey!
Your champion looks dizzy, Koopa.
Not for long, Princess. Three heads are better than two.
It can't be. They defeated my champion.
And now you've got to let them go.
That's what you think. Brutus, release the lions.
But you promised.
One of the nice things about being evil is you get to lie a lot.
Let's stomp on some Goombas. Now, I brought this up earlier. Toad makes a certain sound effect.
Oh, wants, the squeak toy sound effect. Yeah.
The baby toy sound effect. We're 5 episodes in. I'm so sick. So sick of it already. I cannot stand it.
I don't understand that decision at all. I'm like, why is he making that sound?
Like, okay, I get using the classic game sounds for when, obviously, Mario gets a power-up. Or Mario gets hit or injured and having the wah-wah-wah, whatever the sound effect is. I don't understand why Toad has to sound like a squeak toy.
Yeah, he pretty much sounds like a doggy squeak toy.
Yeah, I just don't get it. And you brought it up earlier in this episode of the podcast, why they skipped over the mushroom power-up.
Mm-hmm.
Think about it. In the 80s, everybody was doing drugs.
That's true. And, you know, like I said earlier, you know, the whole Super Mario... And Super Mario 1 was basically based on Alice in Wonderland, and that story was written by a guy, high as a kite and probably had to be scraped off the ceiling after he was done. So yeah, so leaving the mushrooms out was probably that, and I think it was also just kind of it was kind of like a redundant thing. It's like, okay, how do we explain Mario growing and shrinking? I know, let's just not do that. Yeah, so it was kind of like a decision based on two or three different things.
Yeah, pretty much. What didn't you like about this one?
Kind of not a very Mario-esque setting. I mean, it's, you do have Mario water levels, but this was Mario on a boat. And I'm struggling not to make an SNL reference right now, but it's Mario on a boat, and it's Mario dealing with things that Mario would never have to actually do. It's like, okay, this is another case where they just kind of took an idea and they just threw Mario at it. I think this was, I don't know specifically what story this is, but it kind of reminds me of the first Davy Crockett movie that Disney did, where it was like the Great River Race or something.
Yeah, that's pretty much what it probably resembles. And the only time I've ever seen Mario on a boat is when he got a tail and he was fighting to save the princess from the Koopa kids.
Yeah, but those are airships.
They still look like boats, even though they're airships.
I know.
They still have portholes. If it has a porthole, it's a boat. All right, we're going to move on to the final episode of the day. You lucky listeners, you, it's almost over.
Plumber's Log, number 603. On our way through the Linguini Empire, the Emperor invited us to attend a benefit spaghetti dinner to raise money for orphan mushrooms.
All right, the final episode of the day, night, afternoon, whenever you're listening to this, is The Great Gladiator Gig. This was the Sigmund Fruitcake episode, wasn't it, for the live action?
I believe it was, yeah.
Yeah, I didn't even know who that actor was. Yeah. Like, the live action segments, okay, sure. Get Winnie from Wonder Years, I'll recognize her. Get, obviously, everybody in their right mind, unless you've been living under a rock for the last 50 years, knows who Sergeant Slaughter is. Everybody knows, you know, pretty much everybody knows Nicole Eggert, you know, Babe Watch and all that stuff. You know, there are certain stars in this that are going to show up that people will know. The guy that plays Sigmund Fruitcake, not so much. At first I thought it was Barry Gordon, but then I was like, no, there's no way, because it's not the right voice.
But
in the live-action segment, it almost seemed like it carried over from last episode, where the whole, like you mentioned last episode, where they had to hit them on the head to get them to act correctly.
Yeah.
It almost seemed like Luigi didn't even, I don't even remember him saying that, oh, Mario was hypnotized, or Mario was, like, it just seemed like it was some sort of strange after effect from the previous episode with Dr. Frankenstein.
If I remember correctly, I think he hit his head at the beginning, very beginning of the episode. And for some reason, that made him think he was a chicken.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah, these aren't deep stories, people.
No, I know they're not. I know they're not deep stories, but, like, I think it would have been cool if they had done it the way that I thought it was done, where it was a leftover from the previous episode, but I know they're not that deep of a story. And the Great Gladiator Gig, the basic plot here is that it's not sure. Gladiator movies. Yes, it's crap. Really?
It's kind of Spartacus. It's kind of not. It's,
yeah, it's a combination of many Gladiator movies. I'll put it to you that way.
Yeah.
It was all right. It was better than the last episode, I thought. Because last episode, like we said, boats really didn't happen in the games. So, all right, let's go on and get to the fire flowers before we drag this out too long. Okay.
You must be the guests of honor.
Excuse my brother. He gets nervous around guys six times bigger than him.
Are you the Emperor?
No, I'm Brutus Maximus Grouchimus, guardian of the Colosseum. Follow me.
I'll bet no one tries to sneak in without a ticket.
There may not be anything to sneak into. The orphan's benefit dinner may be canceled.
No spaghetti?
No spaghetti. We got a plumbing problem in the catacombs under the Colosseum, unless it's fixed.
So, finding some fire flowers. He's too busy eating. He's your kind of horse, Mario. Another reference to Mario's constant eating habits.
Yes.
And where? Please tell me where in the world. Like, if the basic story behind this cartoon series is set in the cartoon theme song, it says one day they were working on a drain, they fell down the drain and fell into a wormhole, warp zone, whatever, and ended up in the Mushroom Kingdom. If they ended up there without controlling it themselves, how the hell is pasta, pizza, lasagna? Like, to this point in the show, we have not seen them attempt to go back to Brooklyn. So how do they have all of... First of all, how does the Mushroom Kingdom have all of the stuff that's able to even make spaghetti? I get it. It's supposed to... You know, be showing kids, hey, they're not just stuck here and they're going to starve. They're not, you know, but I just, I don't know. And apparently lions love spaghetti. Yay, lion spaghetti. I don't know. Did you have anything you liked about this one?
Let's see. There was probably the worst pun of the episode, which was Augustus, Septemberus, Octobrus, Koopa.
Yeah. Lame name.
And you mentioned the horse. What I thought was funny is that when they threw the feedback for some reason, I don't remember why they did, the horse immediately stopped and he was like, no feed, no work. And so he just basically let the Mario Brothers, he basically left them out to dry.
And, well, that's because the feed bag was empty.
Yeah.
They didn't have any more. And that's why they threw it away.
Yeah. But another thing about that horse, this is about the episode that I started noticing that all the character designs are kind of like 90s and 20-ish. It's like really weird that they went with that. I mean, that's definitely like a 1920s cartoon horse.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
You know, I was looking back on some of the other episodes. I was like, yeah, it is kind of like that.
Yeah.
So, it's kind of a weird thing they did. Let's see. The lions you mentioned, basically, since it's a gladiator movie, the Mario Brothers had to fight the lions, and Mario's like, wait a minute, why would you want to eat us when you can have a real meal like a king? And the lions are like, that's a great idea. So that's how the Mario Brothers get away.
Yeah, that's...
And there's some plot about them raising money with pasta for an orphanage or something, but it's really not that important.
It's at the end. The whole basic plot was they thought this king, quote unquote king, was for real, and this king was going to have a charity for the orphans of the Mushroom Kingdom, and what was the price? It was one coin for a plate of spare, one coin to get in for spaghetti or whatever else, and they raised the money, but see, that's the thing. Like, yes, I know it's the late 80s, early 90s, and cartoons back then did not have straightforward, continuous plots like we do nowadays in cartoons. I get that. But you would think that somehow, some way, later in this series, they would bring up the Mushroom Orphanage again. I don't know if they ever...
I don't want to give away spoilers, but they do.
Oh, okay. Well, that's good. Yay. Continuity.
Well, but I wouldn't call that continuity because it seems like it's almost like a Tom and Jerry cartoon, the weird way that they kind of they keep throwing the Mario Brothers in different situations, and it doesn't seem to gel at all. It's like, okay, in one episode they're in the Old West, and one episode they're in Spartacus, and one episode they're in space, and it's like, well, how does this all fit together? And it really kind of doesn't, but it's meant to be like a jokey series. And
no, I understand that. It's just like, you know, when I go back and I you know this, yeah. You've done this, you know, you go back and you analyze something, you look at something, and it's like, why does this happen? Are we going to see this again? Is this, you know, something that they're just going to drop? Kind of like in He-Man, there's an episode where some one-shot writer wrote an episode where they basically screwed over whoever the next writer was going to be when they had Evil-Lyn and Beast-Man captured by the palace, like trapped in the Palace of Eternia, and Skeletor was in a different dimension. Never explained it how it was going to, how either of them were going to escape at anyway. All right, let's, do you have anything else you liked about this one before we get to the Goombas?
Not really.
All right, let's go stomp some Goombas. Especially ones with harmonicas.
Guess who's coming to dinner, Tricladius? The Marios.
Mash him, stomp him, crush him.
Hey, don't let him see you, snake breath. I want him to walk into my trap.
Mash him, stomp him, crush him.
Why do I have to give you an order 3 times before it sinks in?
I don't know, ask him, I don't know, ask him.
So we're stomping on some Goombas. As I mentioned before, if the Shroom Kingdom is another dimension, how is there Italian food there? That's something that just kind of like, especially like all of this Italian food for this benefit, for the like, I don't get it. And then another thing that I hope this does not come up.
Do they put mushrooms on the pizzas?
They put certain plants in the brownies. But this last note that I don't like about this episode is real. Like, sometimes I have bad grammar, or I have, you know, bad ways of writing sentences out or saying stuff, but oh my god. I aren't going nowhere. Ah, the bad grammar. Oh my god. It just hurts my head. Ow. What didn't you like about the gladiator gig?
The lions were a little over the top. The lions, they look like oversized kittens. It was like, who designed these? But then again, yeah. I think it's kind of like them doing the 1920s thing. If I remember correctly, the lions, that when they would show up in like really old cartoons, were kind of fluffy and cuddly back then too. So
yeah, that's, all right, so that's it for the episodes today. We're going to take a quick break. You're going to hear some ads and some other stuff, and we will come back to give our final ratings on each of the episodes and final thoughts on this first batch of Super Show stuff. So we'll be back after this.
Yuck! Camel slob!
Mario, it's a mirage. The sun's hard-boiled your brain.
Guys, control yourselves. We've got to ignore all these mirages or we'll never find Aladdin's lamp.
Too bad we gotta ignore that swimming pool.
A swimming pool? Where?
Coming to Grand Rapids, Michigan on September 21st and 22nd is GrandCon Gaming and Comics Convention, presented by Celebration Cinemas. Join us in playing or chatting it up with fellow enthusiasts in a community that understands your passions. Get lost in the adventure of your favorite role-playing game. Admire costumes and art from vendors and attendees. Meet the creators behind your favorite mainstream and independent games and comic books. Check out unpublished games and sneak peek at things to come. You can get all this and more at GrandCon. For more information, please visit www.grand-con.com.
All right, we are back, and we're going to rank each episode from today. We're using a 0 to 5 Starman's scale. Basically, it's 0 to 5 stars, ladies and gentlemen, but since, you know, the star is technically the most powerful weapon in the original game, since it gave Mario invincibility. The bird, what do you rank it, 0 to 5 stars?
I'll give it 2.
Yeah, I gotta give it a 2 as well. It just, I love the live action stuff, but I wanted to declaw that bird. That mother bird is just so cliched. King Mario of Cremelot.
I'll give it 0 Starman and a poison mushroom on top of that.
Oh, wow. You're going all-star, I see. Holy crap. King Mario of Cremelot, while it's not my favorite spoof of the Arthurian legend, I'll give it a 1 star, man. I did enjoy certain things from it, but overall it is kind of bad. Butch Mario and the Luigi Kid.
I'll give it 3 star, man, for the Sergeant Slaughter clips. and the single enemy from Super Mario 3 that is inexplicably in this episode for some reason.
I'm going to give it 4 because I just enjoyed it so much. Yes, the Sergeant Slaughter clips, but the actual cartoon, even though I had a couple of problems with it, I really enjoyed it. Like, even though I saw a face on the cacti, I did not expect the cacti to come to life after they read the poster, and I thought that was just amazing. I thought that was hilarious. Mario's Magic Car Pet Ride.
Ooh. Try not to be entirely negative here. I'm gonna give it a 1, I suppose.
I'm gonna give it a 3.
Really?
It's got some good bits to it, but on a whole, it's not the best. I enjoy bits and pieces of it, but compared to, like, King Mario of Cremelot, it's not that bad. Rolling Down the River.
I'll give this another single star, man. It's just not a very Mario-esque story, and the animation was not so good.
Yeah, I'm going to agree with that. It's, like you said in the episode review, when did Mario ever go on a boat? I'm also going to give it 1 star. It's just, no. It actually, I almost wanted to fast forward that episode. The Great, what the hell is the Great? The Great Gladiator Gig, which is the final episode. What do you give that?
I'll give it a 2. It was mildly amusing, and I can't give it more than a 2 because you have a Spartacus setting, but you don't have any
Spartans.
Yeah, you don't. I'm trying to think of the actor. I can't think of his name. But yeah, you don't. They could have had like so many more jokes in this, and they just didn't go for it.
I'm gonna give it a 2 as well. It just, and the whole thing with the food and all that, I just don't know. No, it gets a 2. All right. Any other final thoughts you want to make before we close out?
No, the only thing that came to mind was the Mariana and Luigina.
Stop.
That was painful.
Yeah, very, very painful. All right. Thank you for joining us here on Pixels in the Animation. There are several ways to get in contact with us or leave feedback for the show. Visit our websites, geekcastradio.com. You can also catch Neil over at Animation Aficionados. Any other websites you want to pimp out your comic series site or something? Yes.
Visit nosuperpants.com for superhero girly goodness.
Email us feedback at geekcastradio.com. Leave the show's feedback in iTunes. It may take up to a week before the podcast is in iTunes. I'm not sure exactly how I'm going to go about doing that, because sometimes, even though we already have the episode zero and we now have this first episode, sometimes iTunes, at least with me, has been really, really weird with even acknowledging a podcast that I submit to it. So it may take a couple of weeks for this to show up in iTunes. You can follow us on Twitter. You can follow the network updates at GeekCast Radio. Mine is TFG and Mike. What is your Twitter?
Yil Sama.
Yep. And you can also become a fan on Facebook. Go to facebook.com/GeekCastRadioNetwork. You can also catch Neil with his animation stuff over at facebook.com/AnimationAficionados.
And I also have Neil's Classic Gaming.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Which gaming page. Talk about weird video game shit.
Yeah, some of it I know. Not all of it, but some of it. I love when you bring up controllers that I cannot even use at all because they're too large. Anyway, call the voicemail line. Tell us, show them the message for and your name. 502-526-5821. We hope you enjoyed this first episode of Pixels in the Animation. Wish you'll join us next time, and we will be reviewing 6 more episodes from the Super Mario Brothers Super Show, those being Mario and the Beanstalk, Love 'em and Leave 'em, The Great BMX Race, Stars in Their Eyes, Jungle Fever, and Brooklyn Bound. Hey, they're actually going home. Wow, that was a quick cartoon. All right, for now, I am TFG1 Mike with
TV's Mr. Neil.
Stay pixelated, everyone, and we will catch you next time.
You know, I'm going to make this joke next week, but when I saw there was a BMX episode, I was like, oh no, an Elks Kid crossover.
Do the Mario swing your arms from side to side. Come on, it's time to go. Do the Mario, take one step. And then again, let's do the Mario all together now. You got it. It's the Mario. Do the Mario. Swing your arms from side to side. Come on, it's time to go. Do the Mario. Take one step. And then again, let's do the Mario all together now. Come on now, just like that.